Ozzie Jerk joins me on the line at this point. Ozzie, I got a lot to talk to you about, so I'm going to get right to it. I want to start with the jump in interest rates. It caught analysts by surprise, only in that it took place in September and not October. What do you think the impact, well, impact on mortgage rates, impact on the market in general?
Well, first of all, you know, there's all kinds of mortgages. So your fixed rate mortgage that you have, don't worry about it. The payment stays the same. But when you come time to renew, it's going to go higher. And of course, if you want to buy a house, yes, you have to pay likely a higher rate already, as banks always anticipate the rates. But the five-year rate is really tied to the bond rate, and the bond rate determines what the rate is. Now, if you have a variable rate mortgage, the payment's definitely going up. In fact, they have already gone up because they are tied to the prime, and the prime went to 3.2% from 2.95%. And the same with home equity lines of credit. What I would do certainly as if I'm contemplating buying or I want to do, should I lock in, should I not lock in, go to our website at jerk.com and play around with the mortgage calculators. We have all sorts of scenarios you can paint for yourself. But also go see a mortgage broker, a quality mortgage broker. I mean, you've had Dustin Woodhouse at the Outlook conference or Kyle Green, who's going to speak at our conference September 30th. You want a quality guy or gal, sit down with you and work out what it would mean, because if there's another 0.5% coming, which we are forecasting in our newsletter by the spring, that full 1% increase in July will make maybe between $140 to $200 a month difference on your payment.
Well, let me come to, I mean, you know, the market in some places certainly doesn't need to slow down, despite the fact everyone wishes it, because I had a look at those Toronto market numbers. We talked about them a month ago and a month before that. My goodness gracious, if you want a price fall, you're getting it.
Yeah, it is certainly, you know, they got a triple whammy. First of all, they just went too high. April was sort of the fool's final blowout price. And then we had at the same time put in a foreign buyer's tax and a slew of other taxes. This week, the Ontario government agreed to the, or rather launched the new Landlord and Tenant Act. And then you have an interest rate increase and you have a higher dollar. All of that ties together to where the Toronto average single family house price dropped by $100,000 a month for 4 months in a row.
Wow.
Ouch.
I mean, yeah, I mean, wow. I'm sort of speechless when I look at that. I mean, what's their average family single home now, and what's it been, sort of thing?
Well, it was about $1.5 million to, and dropped to $1.1 million something. Now, remember, yeah, you have the two area codes. 416 is the more expensive one, but even the 905 area code, which is the outlying areas, dropped by 22%, and so the average price is there down to about 900 something. But the drop is just fast. A lot of people got caught in it. But I think the real impact will be psychological. If I open my paper and I want to buy and I see constantly interest rates are higher, prices are falling, am I going to be a buyer in this market? I'm going to sit back. And what we're seeing in Toronto, unlike Vancouver, the listings are still 65% higher than they were in just a few months ago. And so a lot of people are trying to get out.
Ozzie, yeah, absolutely. And I mean, one of the things you pointed out to us very early on was that fact that the difference between Vancouver and Toronto was when Vancouver initiated all those kind of rules, and then we got the, on top of that, we had the mortgage changes last October. You were saying that, well, look, there still was such a shortage of supply. The same thing happened in Victoria, for example. But man, that wasn't the case in Toronto. And you said that was the key variable. And I'm patting you in the back for that, because you told us, no, this one's going to have a problem, you know, because have got so many more listings. But let me just change gears for a second, a completely different subject. You know, I'm still getting questions like this, Ozzie. People don't kind of get the difference between, if you're looking at an apartment, they see, well, co-op's way cheaper than this one, and it's a strata, or a leasehold, and it's cheaper than a strata. They're not the same thing.
No, they're not. In fact, I talked to Israel, to Rick Hugendorn in Victoria, and they have a building there, which is sort of built in 1969, which is a leasehold building. Well, the owners just got a letter from the owners of the building and the land, because we forget sometimes that as a leasehold, we don't own anything. But they just got a letter to disinstall all the dishwashers. So you can imagine, if you installed it, you had to until September 15 to get rid of them. And you were also reminded that you're not allowed to install dishwashers. Now, that'd be a great surprise to a lot of people. It's probably logical, Mike, because, you know, maybe the building is too old or was never built. But the key is you haven't got any rights. There is no board. There's no there's no recourse as a lease. You just have to accept what comes down the road. Now, in terms of a co-op, which is also different from ownership. At least all of you together own the building, and you have a contract or shares in the corporation. But it's none of it is as good as your strata title, and because that's the best. And because of that, it is more expensive. So if you're just starting out, maybe the leasehold is for you, because it's better to have something that you pay a mortgage reduction on than nothing.
Let me come back to one other quick aspect here. You know, looking at Victoria, for example, you just mentioned it. I'm very familiar with the market. You know, it's been a very strong market over the last 18 months, maybe, you know, or so. Well, you got a leasehold building. It's not going to go with that market. That's one thing people got to get. A co-op or a leasehold don't move the same as sort of a strata title if you're talking condos, and obviously a single detached.
Yeah, and you're absolutely right. And you think on the outside looking in, that should be logical. But some people, they think, oh, well, I own this thing. Well, you don't. A leasehold is a leasehold. Plus, like particularly this building, when you started the lease, it was 99 years, and now over half of that is already gone. So it has diminishing value. But the key is this, you can't also get mortgages on it. So a co-op, for instance, or a leasehold, you need the credit union, and you pay more interest. And there's all sorts of things tied to it. But still, there are some co-op buildings on the west side or downtown that may be 30% less than the strata. And if you don't mind maybe having onerous rules, maybe it's for you. But it is not the same. You're quite right.
Okay, you got about 30 seconds for a hot property.
We got, if you always wanted to be out of town, really out of town, I used to call them the kook heads, you know, no cars, no roads. Well, we got a great waterfront lot on Burns Lake, $29,900, but you got to fly in or use your boat.
There you go. Ozzie, as usual, great stuff, really important information, and I hope what we did is just tweak you there. You know, you don't just casually say, oh, I'll buy a co-op or I'll buy a leasehold or a strata. Find out everything about it today. Plus, more news on the interest rates front as it develops with Ozzie. Ozzie, go out and have a great weekend.
Thank you very much. I have a new tip for my golf pro. He says, swing hard in case you hit it.